And we are back, Faster Data Insights with Power BI. It's been a phenomenal day. I hope it's been really useful. But what I can see on the forums and the feedback that we're getting, you had definitely some value for spending the time with us to drill down into the capabilities of Power BI. Now, what we're going to be covering in this last module for today is the data management gateway. So the data management gateway for that, I actually invited Majdi, one of our lead principal program managers, on this feature to talk about the capabilities that we have in order to connect to on-premise data. I assume you're going to be talking about data refresh and so on.
Yes.
How to configure gateway. So with that, Majdi, how about I just give it right to you? You could tell us a little bit more about your many years of experience at Microsoft, and then we'll drill down into the management gateway.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it, Andy. So I joined Microsoft back in 2000. I started with the Windows Server team. We shipped Windows Server 2003, XP, then up to Vista, Longhorn. And I did some time in services and working on Microsoft Knowledge Management Network. And recently, I started working on Power BI for the last year or so. And I spent most of my time working on the team that's developed the data management gateway and the infrastructure for Power BI. So next, I'll go over some of the details of the data management gateway, how we designed this component, why we use it for, and hopefully we'll give you a very nice demo at the end of it that shows how to configure it, how to create OData feeds, and how to enable scheduled refresh on Excel workbooks. I think you might have seen the slide multiple times today, but just a quick reminder. One of the good features we're looking at in Power BI is the lower barrier of entry for using Power BI. Excel is available everywhere, and you can use just Excel for basically discovering your data, analyzing the data, and visualizing it in a really very simple manner. And with our integration with Office 365, that gives you the whole story end-to-end. Let's dig in into the data management gateway, which is what we're going to be talking about today. For the data management gateway, one of the things I always tell people is when you think about the gateway, think about three main capabilities. And these capabilities can be split into, how can I enable corporate data feeds over OData? How can I enable discovering these content in Power Query? And the last part, which is how do I enable refresh of the data from on-premise to the cloud in a hybrid model through Power BI? So this is these are the three main core components that we would like to think about at the gateway. And if you look at it, if you look at the concept, it's very similar overall. But there's a lot of details and complexities in the back end to make all of this happen. So if we look at the components that we have the data management gateway sitting in two different places. One on-premise through a client and one in the cloud through a service that's part of Power BI. We have the Power BI admin center where we configured the gateway. And we have what we call a secure confidential credential store where we keep the user names and password when you're using the gateway. In a nutshell, how does the gateway work? So you are in Power Query. And using Power Query, you can connect to an OData feed that's published by the gateway. That OData feed connects to the data management gateway, which in turn connects to the data source, whether it's a SQL server or Oracle server in the back end. It will execute whatever query you want, retrieve the data for you, and publish it back to Power Query. This is the mechanism that for OData feeds and having some simple access through Excel. At the same time, you can create what we call a scheduled refresh capability for the gateway that enables you to publish data models in Power BI and to set up a scheduled refresh that can take place at any point in time to get you a fresh copy of the data that you have. And let's quickly take a look of how that works. So we start with the Excel workbook that you have. You upload that Excel workbook online, and you click on the refresh data for the Excel workbook. That connects you to the data gateway cloud services. Again, like we talked, the data gateway has two components, one in the cloud that's part of Power BI, and we have a client that actually sits on-premise. So between the cloud component and the on-premise component, we get a check to make sure that you have the right set of credentials and the capabilities to perform whatever action you tried and you're authorized for that. Once that's completed, then we send a query to the backend SQL server to get to retrieve the data that you're looking for. The result goes back through the same pipeline, and we efficiently transfer that back through our hybrid connectivity service through the gateway, and you get your results back in the Excel workbook. Next, I'm going to talk quickly about the Power BI Admin Center. So the Power BI Admin Center plays a very central role in managing the gateway. It enables you to configure the gateway, install it, set up the secure communication between the on-premise component and the cloud component. You can configure access to the cloud through the admin center, and you can expose the OData feed through your configuration there. And if you notice, although we talk about self-service BI model, for this component, you really need the help of your IT admin in your organization to complete these steps. So I think, you know, the best way to get a really clear view of what we talked about here is to dig into this and try to show a demo of how to set up the gateway, set up some data sources, and see how all this works.
Sounds good.
All right. So on my screen here, we see I'm actually in the Office 365 admin center. I have created a special tenant for us today to use for this demo. I went to powerbi.com and I just created a test tenant. I log into my test tenant and that takes me to the main landing page for Office 365 with Power BI. Here I can see the health status of my service and it shows that Power BI for Office 365 is actually up and running with no problems. Next, I'm going to basically go to the admin center for Power BI, and I can access that from the top bar where I go admin, I click on Power BI, and that will take me into this portal here. As you see, the admin center has multiple components. One of it is system health that gives you...
Yeah, I had to put that into, like, postpone that.
Yeah, I'll just postpone that for you, you know, right timing here. You have different components. You look at the system health. You look at the data sources, gateway, role management, setting, and getting started. So let's dig in a bit deeper into here. In order for you to actually set up the gateway, you start in this place, and you go, I need to create a new gateway. So let's call it, you know, test. Test gateway. And if you notice here, I got a checkbox that says enable cloud credential stall to achieve business continuity. What this means is through Power BI, I can basically take a cached copy of the credentials that I'm using and keep it in the cloud. Some people will use that feature. Some people will turn it off. By default, it's turned off, and you have to enable it to enable that. If you've noticed on some of the slides that we showed earlier, we had the credential stores that's on-premise. So this is basically a cached version of that.
So is that a cached version of Active Directory sitting on Windows Azure?
Not all Active Directory, but for the users and accounts that you configured in Power BI to access the gate.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So it doesn't replicate everything. So let's go ahead and hit create. So we didn't give it a valid name. We have a space here. You can't have spaces there, so... just by clicking that, I basically created my gateway instance in the cloud service. And the next component would be to install the client service. And to install the client service, you can directly click download, and that will take you to our download center. And you can download the data management gateway from here. You'll notice that we have two versions, one for 32-bit and one for 64-bit. To save us some time, I've already downloaded the file and installed the gateway. When you install the gateway, this is what it's going to look like. And let's go back here. The next thing that you want to do is basically you want to identify the gateway with the cloud service, with the cloud service component of the gateway, and that's done through a secure key that's used to establish the communication. What you do is you take a copy of that key, just like copy and paste, so you highlight it, you copy it, and you go to the gateway client that's installed on the local machine here. And what I've done is I've already entered that key and registered the gateway to make sure it's up and running for us in this demo. But what you will do is you'll generate the key, install it here, and hit OK, and that will establish the communication between the on-premise gateway component and the cloud component. And once you do that, you'll notice the status here. It says either registered or not registered. That key is not kept anywhere, so we don't keep a copy of that key. And if you lose that key, then you'll have to go back to the gateway and regenerate it. So let's click finished here. And if you can see here, the gateway that I've just created shows stopped because I didn't configure it with the client on premise. So let's delete this one and just look at the demo one that's running here. That one I created previously to enable us to complete this demo. This gateway here has the same key as the on-premise gateway, and they're up and running. In case you run into a situation where you have a problem with the connectivity between the on-premise client and the cloud service, you are able to regenerate the key. So if you can't regenerate, that will give me a new key. I can then highlight that new key and then go back to my cloud service and I say, I want to change the key on the cloud service. Let's make sure we have the same key here. And you hit OK. Let's try again. So one of the things you need to be careful with is when you're doing the copy, to make sure that you copy the whole key. And you can see now that it worked and it's up and running, okay?
Perfect.
So now we have established the communication between the on-premise component over here and the cloud component. One of the things that you can look at when you're configuring the on-premise component is you can choose which type of communication is taking place over HTTP between the cloud and on-premise. You can choose to either have HTTP or HTTPS. And if you choose HTTPS, then basically you need to provide a certificate to encrypt that communication. And what that certificate is coming from is up to you as an IT admin for that organization and to enable you to manage it with the rest of your certificates. So let's go back here and talk about the next step in the setup of the data gateway. So the first step, like we said, we install the gateway. On-premise, we generate a key, and we take that key to establish the communication between on-premise component and the cloud. Once that's up and running, as the case here, then that gateway is enabled, and now we can define data sources on-premise to be able to connect to it and get access to it. So defining a new data source, you come to the Data Sources tab, you click plus New Data Source. And when you're defining your new data source, you can say, this is a data that I want to be able to refresh data from the cloud to, or if it's just an OData source. So you can either have one of them either, or you can have both. So in this case, I'm just going to create a new data source that's an available of both. Test 2. And the next step in defining the data source is you select which gateway is going to be running off. In that case, we have only one gateway defined, so we use this gateway. And then we say, you know, it's a SQL server. And here you can either provide a connection string, or you can provide detailed connection properties. In this case, let's provide connection properties. I have a locally installed version of SQL Server on my machine, and it has a database, a sample database running on it that we will be using it. So the server is MeshDB, and the database is Northwind. I think everybody knows our database. And then you can specify the credentials that you're going to be used to access that data source. And here, these are actually the credentials that have the privileges to get access to the data in the back end. You can use either Windows or database. In my case, I have a database configured. So enter username and the password. And you can test the connection, says OK. And what you see here is the gateway actually has opened the connection back to the SQL server that I have. These are the tables that are available in the database that I want to expose. And if you can see here, it has retrieved for me all the tables and the views that's actually available in the backend database. And now I can choose either to publish all of the tables, or some of them, and I can publish all of views or some of them. So let's say we're going to publish all the tables, and we're going to just publish a couple of views. And we hit next, finish, and that will create a new data source for you. So what you see here now, there's the refresh demo data source that I have created previously, and there's the test data source that I just created. And this one here is, cloud access enabled, and I have a URL data feed for it, and the same thing for this one. So the OData feed is basically the URL that you have here, so you can copy that if you want. And if we go back to Excel, and let's say start an empty Excel workbook, go to Power Query, and say I want to access data from an OData feed, I can provide the URL that was provided to me on the gateway site here. Again, this is the URL for the OData feed that you can publish for your users. And hit OK. And if you notice here, I'm actually logged in into my organization account, which is the Power BI tenant that I have created. And I click Sign In. That's my tenant. And if you've noticed, the hybrid proxy service, which is part of the gateway infrastructure, was getting the details of, you know, whatever I have published as part of my data source here. And if you can see here, I can basically view the data, say load, for example. And that will retrieve the data from the back end. Okay. So this shows us how we enabled an on-premise component to be accessed through an OData feed that's was defined by the gateway. Well, let's click get rid of that and come back here for a second. If you notice, when I define my data source, I've actually defined a username and a password. And that username and a password is going to be the credential used every time that gateway tries to access the backend SQL server or Oracle server, for that matter, if it's an Oracle source. Keep in mind that whatever username and password the user is coming in is not going to be captured. And in order for the user to be able to access that data source, you need to actually define the users on that source. So let's go back here for the gateway. Okay. Sorry, the data source. And when you define the data source, you realize here that we have users and groups. And you have to actually add the user that's going to be accessing that data gateway as a user here. So if you don't actually add that user, automatically there will be declined access to that data to control the security. One thing to keep in the back of your mind is any auditing that you have on the SQL server is not going to show your user that's coming in through the data source, but it will show the user that you used to set up the account there. Okay. So I'm just going to delete that source that we created here. And for our next component, I'm going to look at the source that I have defined previously for the refresh. So again, this is a data source that I defined over the gateway. It's cloud-enabled. It's OData-enabled. I have a connection string that defined the backend access. So this is, you know, when we did the first demo, we talked about connection properties, and we filled that one, and we said you can use a connection string. If you use a connection string, you just basically put it in here, copy the connection string, and use the credentials. Let's now move to back to our Power BI instance. And let's take a look at the steps that you would take to actually create an Excel workbook, upload it to Power BI, and create a scheduled refresh for that. So again, let's log in into Excel. And we can have an empty Excel sheet. We go to Power Pivot to create a model. And in the Power Pivot, we can either use existing connections, or we can create new connections and define the new connections. To save us some time, I've actually created a connection, and we can use that connection here. This is the connection string. Right. You know what? Let's do it from scratch. And one of the things to keep in the back of your mind is when you're creating this model, remember to take this connection string that you have here, copy that and save it. We're going to use it later. Again, we're testing the connection. It's working. And we're going to, for example, import the products table here. Okay. So here I've created an Excel sheet that has the product name and the product ID. And I'll take that Excel sheet and I'll save it online to my SharePoint online Power BI site. I've gone ahead and done that to save us some time. So if you look here, I've uploaded the Excel file that we just created, similar model to it. And if you look at this Excel file, it basically has, you know, the product and the product idea. This is a reflection of the backend table that I have defined previously. In order for me to actually enable refresh of this model that I have here, you go back to the document library and you click on the scheduled data refresh. The scheduled data refresh will give you the setting screens here that will enable you to define, you know, is the refresh on or off? When you define it that it's on, it will ask you for which connection string you're going to be using. You specify the connection string, and then you specify whether you want the refresh to be done daily or weekly, and what time to end it by. And then you can specify an approximate time of when that refresh is going to take place. You don't actually specify an exact time. So it's about 5:14 now. So let's say we want this to be done around 5:15. Let's go back to our table here, and let's say we're going to edit some of the data here. Chai. So we modified three rows that we have here, and we're going to save the configuration and say refresh the report. And if you look at the history here, it will show that the next refresh is going to happen at this point in time. Now let's go back and look at the file itself. So you see this is the rows that I modified. It still hasn't refreshed. Look at the scheduled refresh and the history. And we can see here that the refresh process is running. Now, one of the things that you're going to notice is it might take about, you know, 10, 15 seconds for that refresh to complete. And the reason for that is we've optimized the refresh process to handle large amount of data. So if you're looking at, you know, between a few rows to about 10,000 rows of data that you're refreshing, you're looking at the same throughput. And that's why it might seem that it's taking a long time, but it's because of the way we have optimized the process. So that's how the scheduled refresh actually works. In a second, once it completes, we can come back and look at the data. So it says completed at this point in time. We can come back to the file itself, and we can see we have the data has been updated to reflect the changes that I've done there. So that's how the scheduled refresh will work. So in a nutshell, this is the capabilities of the data gateway. Enables on-premise data access. It enables you to expose all data feeds for your corporate sources. One of the things that's actually, or one of the flexible things that the gateway provides for us is the capability to create an SSIS packages and connect an old data head on top of it and actually expose that as a feed that you can access from Power Query also very easily using the URL for the old data feed. That would cover our discussion for today.
So a question on the forum here is old data feed versus a shared Power Query.
Yeah.
What are the pros? What are the cons?
So The Power Query is already configured and available in the info catalog for you. So basically, in the future, you're going to see that we're going to provide you the capability to refresh Power Query.
Yeah.
While in the case of the old data feed, you're actually having, every time you're opening that, you're accessing the backend data to get the data if you save it just as a file. Mm-hmm. If it's a model, right, then you're going through the gateway. So that basically the main difference there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. I think the data management gateway is just a great way to set up the connection, the data refresh. I think you explained that pretty well. We had some amazing attendance on the event, and before you all leave from the live event, I do want to ask you to take the poll if you haven't done yet. But for as far as I can see, we have about 99% of the people that voted. So we're still waiting on that one person. With that, what we're going to do is we're going to wrap this up and kind of go over what we talked about today and what's going to happen next on how you can get access and so on. I do want to thank Majdi for coming here as the last presenter. I know that's probably the least desirable spot, but this is definitely the right moment to talk about the data management gateway, really pulling everything together.
Thank you, and I hope everybody likes what they see.
As I switch to the presentation here, so some of the things that we probably want to talk about is how do you get your hands on Power BI? And I've seen some questions that came up on the forum where people were asking about licensing and so on. We did not answer all of those questions basically because all the information in terms of licensing usage is actually available on the PowerBI.com portal and through that. So if you go to powerbi.com, and as Majdi mentioned at the end of his presentation, just for this session, he set up a trial tenant. You can actually get that service up and running in a few minutes. So the only thing you have to do there is go sign in, sign up, pass your information, and you have that fully integrated Office 365 tenant and the capabilities to also download those Office 365 bits that have the synonym capability in there to go to Power Pivot. There's before you leave, there's a couple of things that I want to show you on how easy it actually is to start using Power BI. So what I'm going to do there is I'm going to go switch back to my Excel workbook and I actually showed you the New York City data that we have here, right? So let me just open it up real quick. I'm going to go to this About tab just to show you some quick capabilities and on how fast you can actually get this going. So in some of the samples that we've been running, what we actually did is say we said, hey, you know what? We're going to go to New York City data set here. And I'm just going to copy the City of New York URL that is actually exposing the API. So what we see through this API is we're getting a JSON document returned, and I'm going to bring that into an empty Excel workbook just for the fun and the matter of this, right? So I'm going to go to Power Query, and now I'm going to go from web, copy-paste that URL in there, and what I'm actually pulling right now is the last 1,000 New York City 311 calls, and I can grab this list and convert that to a table. And because I do get a JSON document in return, what I can do next is I could then just quickly expand that and say, hey, which columns are you interested in? So I want to know the zip code. I want to know when the actual, what the longitude was for that location. What else do we have here that might be interesting for us to look at? We want to see the latitude as well. We want to see the complaint type and maybe the descriptor. Okay, the borrow, just select the columns that we actually need there to actually get that. And there should be something in there that's going to show me the unique key, the created date. Okay, so we got a couple of things there that I can go through, such as a complaint type. So let's grab this real quick. Okay, I can then go to the process of renaming the zip code or the lat long or whatsoever. But what I can actually really do is let's have a look at that create date and say like, hey, I want to change the data type here and say like, we want to see that as a date time. Bang, there we go. Instantly, it's mapped as a date time. Okay? Just for the matter of, I don't even need to rename this. I can now say, hey, we want to load this to the worksheet. Okay, so we'll hit apply and close on this one. Okay? So what we do next is we have that query. Now, the great thing about this query is that this query will be refreshable, right? So what I can do now is I can quickly go into some of the other capabilities, highlight that table, say, hey, how about we insert a power view just on this, okay? So now we're getting our power view workbook. We can easily bring those columns in, and we see all of the columns in there. But what I was interested in is, hey, I wanted to see to borrow, and actually we want to see the borrowing created date, but created date is something that we're actually going to count on. So we see the last 1,000 calls per borrow. We're going to represent this as a, let's say, a stacked column chart or a column chart. Okay, so there we go. Hup, we have our visualizations right there. Okay, so what I can see is the last 1,000 calls, looking at the actual complaint type, bringing in again the number of calls that we had there. Okay, so quickly, hup, there we go. We're gonna build this, put that as a bar chart. We can then filter on that. Just very simple, show the complaint types. And looks like it actually must have been snowing in New York yesterday, because I see I have a great amount of complaints that are related to snow. Now, the interesting thing is we're going to go back to your filtering and see, like, is there any difference between, let's say, Staten Island, where we have seems to be a snow problem there right now as well. Or we look at that compared to Manhattan. So what I see is the difference. It's like, oh, there we go. Filtering, more noise complaints, more complaints about the street light condition or commercial noise. Just like that, pulling in a public data source. That's my power view, right? So what I'm going to do next now is I'm going to go back in here and say, hey, let's go back to this actual workbook. And now we're going to go insert. We're going to click on the map, launch power map, and bring that into visualization. So what I wanted to show you with this is, hey, look at this. I'm literally just spending a couple of minutes on showing you those capabilities, and I bring that into visualization. Look at that. Automatically it detected on the right-hand side here. You see it automatically detected the geography, the incident zip, the lat long. I can now, that happens if you run the preview on this. I can now just bring that in, bring that directly into a power map. And so one of the questions that I had earlier is like, how many records could you realistically put into this? I had no problem on my own laptop, which has 16 gigs of RAM, to visualize over 6 million calls onto a power map and bring that into visualization. Now, to sum it up, once that we then publish that workbook onto a Power BI site, okay, we can then go to the site, grab it from there, interact with the browser on that as well, or even take that into that Power BI application, okay? So here's one of these other Power View reports that I had, and hey, look, I have my New York City 311 complaint calls. What we're actually doing there is we also pulled in an API that we set to be refreshable. So what Majdi talked about that refreshable data source, we actually published that, said now we want to refresh that report on a specified interval. Again, it will then pull in the last 1,000 complaint calls. And I can actually see that across each of the dates. So I have that API here, and I could just, reload my report. I must have timed out on the connectivity there. And then I could just refresh that data set fairly simple, all from within the Power BI app. Okay. So where do we go from here? Power BI sign up. Give it a try. Start playing with that. Start working with the capabilities that we exposed you to there. There's a lot of samples and a lot of examples that are available on the Power BI site. If there's anything that you want to follow up with, is feel free to actually reach out to me through any kind of social media form. Okay, so my contact information is in there, my Twitter handle is in there, email address is pretty easy for a Microsoft employee. That's in my case, Dandy dot wine or dandyw@microsoft.com. We gladly follow up with you on any questions that you might have. There's a lot of forums that we do have available as well. Keep in mind that everything that we covered and that we showed you today is also going to be presented and available through the MVA website. So through the Microsoft Virtual Academy, you can get access to everything that we presented today. I already talked to some of the other presenters as well, like, hey, we get a lot of questions in terms of, can we get access to your sample data? Do you want to post the scripts? So over the next couple of days, what we will do is we will actually post a blog And I think that's going to be more on an individual blog perspective. On some of the sample data, how we got there, I already have that confirmation that Matt Mason is actually going to look at that for you as well, because the majority of questions and capabilities go like, wow, Power Query is quite phenomenal. And then you can easily get into that Power BI and be able to enable Q&A on that one as well. With that, thanks for joining us. I know it's been a long, long day of a lot of learning, a lot of things you need to consume, most likely. So with that, good luck. Thanks for joining us, and see you next time. Thanks.